Michele Milano from the University of Bologna, Italy. Now I'll begin my introduction by saying that Michele is still very young, but she's from the oldest university in the entire world. And I'm sure many of you would have known her as the PC chair of last year's CT conference that was held in Canada. More importantly, she's actually on the editorial boards of the Constraint Journal, Constraint Programming Letter, as well as the Informed Journal on Computing. Michele's research is really in the intersection of constraint programming and operations research. And in fact, she's one of the main persons behind the creation of the CKIOR community. She was the program chair of CKIOR 2005 and 2010. Her recent research interest also includes computational sustainability. She was the master class chair and chair of the third international conference on computational sustainability. And her latest project was on policy making, right? And her invited talk, she's going to share her experience in how she can apply optimization to making policy making better. Okay, without further ado, I'll give the floor to Michele.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay. So thank you very much, Jimmy Lee, and thank you also Christian for inviting me here and all the program committee. So it's a big pleasure for me to tell you something about one research direction that I am currently investigating in kind of in the last 2 years. And it's really optimization for improving the policy-making process. So this is, first of all, I have to say that this is a joint work with a number of people coming from very different backgrounds. We have computational social scientists, we have environmental experts and collaborating with policymakers and public bodies, with an energy consultant company and with computer scientists. In the last part, you might see someone that you know, so Alan, Lars, Barry, Marco Gavanelli, and so on. So basically, the project. So I started a couple of years ago with the crazy idea that we could use decision making for helping policymakers in taking decisions, more transparent, informed decisions. And I tried to apply to an FP7 project, so it was funded at the end. And it's a project that is goes under the call ICT Tools for Governance and Policy Modeling. So basically, the aim is to provide decision support systems to policymakers, and we are trying to devise a general methodology, but we apply it on a case study, which is the energy plan of the Emilia-Romagna region. So up to now, we are considering the renewable energy production where the Emilia-Romagna region wants to invest. And of course, we have used the past data from the previous plan from 2011 to 2013, and now we are ready to use the system that we have developed for the next energy plan. So, in generally speaking, the policy issues, public policy issues, are very complex. They are rapidly changing an uncertain environment and involve conflict among different interests. For example, you have the interest of the region, of the public body, and you have the interest of the citizen that are might be very, very different. Policy making in the energy sectors account for electric and thermal energy production. It accounts for transports and for energy efficiency. Of course, all these policies affect the environment, the economic development, and social acceptance also. The policymakers are now trying to consider more and more often the possibility of devising sustainable energy policies. So we have studied the process of the creation of a policy, and basically this process traverses four steps. Three of them are ex ante steps, or should be ex ante steps in principle, and one is an ex post step. So the planning step is the first one, where strategic objectives are defined. Then the environmental assessment is a procedure that is aimed to understand which is the impact on the environment environment of the policy. Then we have the implementation phase, where the plan should be put into action, and the policymaker should decide which instruments to implement and to which instruments to give money for implementing the policy. And then we have the ex post phase, which is the monitoring. So basically, during while the policy is running, we have to monitor which are the effects of the policy. So we have two drawbacks in the process now, at least in Italy. The first one is that these three steps, planning, environmental assessment, and implementation, are partitioned, so they are performed in sequence. So first a plan is devised, and then the environmental assessment is performed. So there's not much space to improve the plan if we do it a posteriori. And also, all these steps are performed manually, okay, by policymakers, with no support from ICT tools. So during the talk, I will try to go into the detail. So we have used optimization techniques, spatial, but for the first two phases. But the interesting part is to merge the third one, the implementation phase. So because there we have to take into account the social reactions, and this is really where the challenge comes from. Okay, so the planning phase, just to give you a flavor, in the planning phase, a policymaker should set budget constraints, geophysical constraints. There are some regions, for example, that are very windy, some other, there's the Emilia-Romagna region, that are not at all windy, so you have to fix some maximum amount of energy that could be produced by a specific source. And a region wants to perceive, for example, European directives, like the 2020 initiative, that says that for 2020 we have to achieve the 20% of reduction of carbon dioxide emissions with respect to the 1997 levels. We have to have the 20% of energy produced by renewable energy sources, and you have to increase the 20% the energy efficiency. So a region wants to perceive this objective, and for example, the EU has targeted different countries with a specific percentage of renewable energy that should be produced. Italy should be somewhere around the 17%. Okay, so basically, a planner, he should do? So he should decide the renewable energy share. So in the Emilia-Romagna region, the policymakers have decided not to build new energy plants from non-renewable energy sources. So just renewable energy sources are considered. The policymaker has identified the present consumption of energy in 2010 for devising the plan 2011-2013, and it has projected to the 2020 horizon. He has we can remove the energy saving that should be achieved by other political actions, of course, and then projected back this number to obtain this number, 177 kilotons of oil equivalent of electrical energy from renewable energy sources. So this is an objective that we want to achieve. And the idea is that the policymaker should decide the renewable energy share for achieving this amount of energy. Clearly, different sources have different efficiency. So biomass power plant, for example, produce energy 24 hours per day, so in principle it could be possible. PV plants, or during the daylight, wind energy only occasionally. So basically we have different ratio between the installed power and the energy produced. And of course this is a table that is specific for each region, because in Emilia-Romagna and in Sicily, which is in the south of Italy, then this the sun is very different, so of course also the efficiency of the photovoltaic, for example, is higher in the south of Italy, for example. Okay, so during the planning phase, we have to understand, so we have to define these energy shares. So we have two kind of activities that we have to insert into the plan. Primary activities that are those producing energy, so that are PV plants, biomass power plants, mini hydro, geothermal, thermodynamic solar plants. So we have a plethora of energy sources that could be taken into account, but we have also to consider the fact that for obtaining new energy plants, we have also to build infrastructures. And these infrastructures are called secondary activities in our model. So power lines, dams, roads, and so on. And these secondary activities and primary activities have a cost and have an impact on the environment. So building a plan basically means solving an optimization problem where we have to define the quantity of primary and secondary activity in the plan. They have a cost, they have an impact on the environment. We have constraints on impact, on cost, on geophysical characteristics, as I told you before. For example, for wind energy, Emilia-Romagna is not very windy, so we have to impose upper bound on the maximum amount of power that we could install for this source. We, the first stage, we have considered linear constraints between basically between pressures and receptor. I will go to this in a minute because it's in the environmental part. And we can have multiple objective function. For example, the policymaker could say, well, I want to minimize the cost, I want to maximize the energy produced, but I want to be very careful about the air quality. For example, in Emilia-Romagna, the quality being flat, the quality of the air is very polluted. So basically, we don't want, so policymakers do not want to worsen the situation. So we have a multiple objective function we have used for finding Pareto optimal points, a method which is called normalized normal constraint method, and basically provides a set of Pareto optimal points that are also uniformly distributed. So basically we have a very simple model here. We have that each activity has a lower bound and an upper bound. The upper bound is usually determined by geophysical characteristics of the region, while the lower bound is determined by political choices. So I want to have at least a certain amount of megawatt installed by photovoltaic. Then we have a budget, a total budget of the plan, so each activity has a cost, CI. So we have a constraint on cost. We have that the activity should produce at least the energy that the plant should achieve, the 177 kilotons of oil equivalent that I told you. We have a relation between primary activity and secondary activities. Of course, we have to understand how many infrastructure have to build to, for example, power lines to connect a new plant to the grid. So I have also to consider the cost of these activities and the impact on the environment. So basically, at the end of this stage, we can propose to the policymaker a number of alternative scenarios. So each of these points on this curve is a plan, so it's a kind of energy share. So we have all the, I don't know if you can see them, but the first one is PV, the second one is hydro, mini hydro, thermoelectric, and so on. So you have an energy share, and each of these points is one scenario, one possible scenario. And the policymaker so can decide, basically, which is the best scenario he can choose. So in this case, just to underline that using the data from the plan 2011-2013, this one, this blue spot here, is the plan that has been produced by expert. And we have two plans, for example, that dominate that plan. And one which has, this is the air, the quality of the air, and we have the cost. So we have basically two alternative plans with the same quality of the air, but a lower cost, or the same cost, but a better quality of the air. So basically, we can improve the decision of the experts, and that this improvement could be also very, very, very important. Okay, so first of all, we have this planning step. Then we can consider the second step. But while in general they are performed one after the other, so they are partitioned, in our model we can join the two because we can use the same we can insert the environmental assessment into the same model. So we want to understand the impact of activities contained in the plan on the environment. Now this step is performed after the plan is decided, so we can only apply corrective countermeasures if the plan negatively affects the environment. So basically, we are using, so we have worked a lot with environmental experts, and we have tried to encapsulate the tools that they are currently using for performing the environmental assessment into the model. So what they are using now is two kind of two matrices. They are called coaxial matrices. So we have the first matrix links activities to environmental pressures. I will tell you in a minute what they are. And the second matrix is linking pressures to receptors. So basically, activities are primary and secondary activities. So we have all power plants and infrastructures, okay, that are contained in the plan. We have the, we use a matrix with 93 possible activities. Environmental pressures. What is an environmental pressure? Well, environmental pressure is, can be positive or negative. A negative pressure can be, for example, the production of waste, production of noise, production of electromagnetic field, emission of pollutants into the atmosphere, emission of pollutants into the water, and so on. And also, we have some positive pressures that could be obtained through activities like the creation of new ecosystems, saving of natural resources, and so on. So then these pressures are translated into indicators that measure, in one sense, the health of the environment. And these are called receptors, so the quality of the air, of the water, underground water, surface water, and so on, of the sea, and so on. So basically, these receptors are indicators of the health of the environment, of many, many different aspects of the environment. What is the limitation of this, coaxial matrices? They are qualitative, okay? So they are now currently used by environmental experts, not only in Emilia-Romagna, but for example in the whole, in many regions of Italy. But the problem is that these matrices here are contain high, medium, and low values, which is, I mean, not very informative at all. So for example, they say that biomass power plant has a very high negative pressure on gas emissions because biomass power plant emits, for example, particulate matters, but has a very high pressure on good, which is a good pressure on the creation of working opportunities. So these are really, I mean, it's something, but it's not very informative because it's qualitative, okay? And this is the tool that is currently used. This is what So, okay, we can translate, we can use this, we have used this this tool basically by linking, I mean, with linear equation. I mean, in this case, we can have some nonlinear term because some pressures and receptors interact in a nonlinear way. Through, I mean, they're called synergies, positive and negative synergies. But anyway, so we can link pressures to activities and receptors with pressures and obtain a kind of indication of, I mean, how much the plan impacts the environment in a qualitative way. So basically, with the five points that you saw before on the Pareto line, then we have that for each of these receptors, we have a quality of the plan. So we can compare this plan. We can compare these plans with respect to the receptors that are most important in a specific region. So this is basically can be performed together with a plan and with a plan construction, and so we can come out with an environmental assessed plan, which is very different from producing a plan and then checking the quality of the plan in an environmental perspective. So this is what we the environmental experts do now. Basically, we have done something more. So we want to have a kind of, I mean, quantitative description of the impact of a plan on the environment. And we have considered emissions, so emission computation. Basically, we have inserted into the model some tables that basically link every single power source with gases, I mean emissions, sulfate oxide, nitrogen oxide, methane, carbon oxide, and so on. Then we have also used a table measuring the heavy metals and particulate matters and dioxin emissions of each plant. So we can have a measurable idea of how much the plant impacts the atmosphere quality. So basically, we have inserted the emissions into the model, but And of course, these emissions are constrained by law, so you cannot basically produce a plan that, in principle, is outside of the bounds imposed by the law. In Emilia-Romagna, there are additional directives constraining them. So, for example, if you want to build a plan that produces particulate matter, you have to close or reduce a corresponding plan that produces the same amount of particulate matter. So we have, you should have a zero balance. And this is basically a constraint that we have imposed into the model. But for pollutants, we have nonlinear interactions among them. How are they derived? Because basically, in the atmosphere, there are chemical reactions between them, and we are trying to infer. So we cannot simply put the chemical reaction into the model. So, but we can. We are trying to infer which are the synergies between them, and we are using simulator, which takes into account, which is currently used by the ARPA Emilia-Romagna, which is basically, the place where environmental experts perform the strategic environmental assessment of the plan, is an agency of the region. So this simulator considers weather condition, like humidity, temperature, wind, and the number of pollutants, which are considered singularly, and also the chemical reactions between them are considered. So we are trying to infer from the simulation which is the air quality. So it's a kind of indication of the health of the air in the region. So basically, this simulator now is perfectly working, and it is used for deriving on a daily basis the quality of the atmosphere in the region. So in that case, you can see that it's, this is in Italian, I'm sorry, but we have some place with a good, buona means good quality of the air. Then the yellow part is acceptable, and the orange part is not so good, okay? So but it could be worse, of course. Okay, there are two other colors that are really, with a poor quality of the air. So this simulator takes into account the daily forecast and the daily conditions, the weather conditions that are not forecast, and computes the quality of the air on the basis of the pollutants that are emitted into the atmosphere. So we have used the same simulator for performing a kind of forecast for 1 year using the added emissions from the plant, and we are trying to infer the quality of the air from the simulator, taking into account a kind of yearly average temperature and weather condition and wind and so on. So basically, this is a big improvement, I think, in the strategic environmental assessment, because we can really understand and evaluate quantitative measures instead of just high, medium, and low pressures, which are very, very far from the reality sometimes. Okay, so basically, after these two steps, we have a set of plans. They have been, they are environmentally assessed. We can consider all the legal constraints on emissions, or we can consider also the air quality in a more quantitative way, and we are now basically done. But we have to consider the third part, which is the most challenging to my perspective. So after a plan is decided, then the policymaker should translate a plan into actions. So basically, it's the region can say, well, in 2013 or 2020, I would like to have this amount of megawatt installed for photovoltaic. But then who is building these plans? It's not the region, of course. There are private enterprises, the citizens. So what a region can do, what a public body can do in general, is to devise a set of instruments, subsidies, for example, for implementing a policy. So in the energy case, there are a number of them, investment grants. So the region gives you some money for a part of the initial investment for the plant. Feed-in tariffs, so that means a fixed amount of money for each kilowatt hour of energy that you produce. Fiscal incentives, so for example, low interest loan, tax exemptions, green certificates, and so on. So there are a number of instruments that can be considered, but the problem is that each instrument has a cost, and its quantity should be decided. But the question is, how much do these instruments affect and impact the amount of power installed? So basically, we need to understand how people behave, how people react to these policy instruments. So we have used, and we are using into the project, a simulator, an agent-based simulator, that tries to understand the social reaction to incentive mechanisms. And basically, we have basically two steps. So the first one says, okay, suppose we have the perfect simulator. So we have a simulator that perfectly, I mean, measures the social reaction of people to with a on a specific incentive mechanism. So what we can derive from the simulator, how can use these results in an optimization component? So this is the first question. The second question is, we don't have that perfect model, so we have to learn the best possible model for mimicking, for simulating the social reaction. So we have basically two approaches. In the project, we have some social scientists that have their own approach, and we, I mean, we have some at least I have some criticism toward this. I will just tell you in a minute. And we have developed another approach that, and possibly we will combine the two. Who knows? Okay, so now suppose that we have the perfect model. So we have a simulator that simulates the user reaction to subsidies, to incentives, to feed-in tariffs, to basically to economic aspects. So we have simulated, for example, for with a very, I mean, with an agent model that basically takes into account the return on investment, that takes into account, for example, the energy that it consumes, and should decide whether or not to install a PV plant. So we have done this this analysis on photovoltaic plants, and we have simulated with the same agent model for different incentives, investment grants, so just the money that is given from the region to as a part of the initial investment for the plant, interest fund, which means the agent asks for a loan to a bank, and the region pays for the interest. So basically, the agent pays the exact amount of money that he asks. Then we have the guarantee fund. So the agent asks for a loan to the bank. He pays both the capital plus the interest, but the region guarantees in case he cannot pay anymore. See, this is another form of incentive that is a regional incentive. And then we have fiscal incentive. It's the region that provides low interest loans. Okay, so as you can see, with the same agent model, we have different behavior of these incentives. So we have simulated each point our 300 simulation runs. Approximately, each simulation takes 20 seconds. And basically, we have performed, for each incentive, we have 12K simulation. And then we have approximated these simulations through regressions with the curve. Okay, so we have obtained, at some point, a relation between the budget that the region can invest and the forecasted installed power. So if we have this relation, then we can insert this relation into the decision model, and then we can come up with a plan plus the incentive mechanism to achieve the plan. Okay, so basically, if I say that I want to install a given amount of megawatt in a given for a given energy source, but I don't have enough money for subsidizing this, then I mean this is not a good plan, because I mean I will not achieve my objective. So the simulator basically should come out with a PV adoption in the region. So the social scientists are also taking into account population data and wealth data and so on. Okay, so now suppose we have this simulator, and suppose this simulator is realistic. Now what we can do, we can insert this relation between funds and allocated funds and the PV adoption into the model, so we can come up with the Pareto optimal curve, which corresponds to an environmentally assessed plan and the corresponding incentive mechanism, so the corresponding implementation actions for achieving the the policy. So we have indeed, we have tried to do that. We have basically found, I mean, approximated the curves before with the piecewise linear functions, and we have inserted into the model a number of constraints linking the budget, basically the budget that has been is provided on a specific for a specific chapter like photovoltaic, and the kind of, I mean, and the funds allocated to each single incentive. And we can come out with a partition of a given budget, for example 20 million euros, to the different incentive mechanism for obtaining a given amount of increased megawatt of power. Okay, so basically this is a possibility, okay, to have the integration of the two components. There is also another avenue that we are investigating with Barry and Lars and Alan, and which basically is they are devising an incentive design component that takes the budget available for these incentives and the amount of power that we want to achieve, and basically computes the best mechanism, the best partition, and the best incentive schema possible for obtaining the plan. And basically, this is based on an altruistic central planner. We have a finite budget to subsidize the renewable energy, the micro generation. We have a set of self-interest agents, and each agent own some private information, private information. So, and of course, that we have also common knowledge, like the pitch of the roof, the orientation, latitude, value of cash flow stream, and so on, and the price to acquire and install the plant. Basically, there is incentive design component, which is described in a paper published at ISMP. Tries to minimize the maximum cost for any agent and incentivize a truthful revelation of private data. So basically, this incentive design can be used together with the optimization component to come out with a partition of the budget that respects budgetary constraints and allocate grants to the best, to the most efficient, agents. So these are basically two possible methodologies. One is to infer the relation between the megawatt installed and the grant into the optimization model, and the second one is to have two separate components computing the first one, the plan, and the second one, a possible incentive mechanism. Okay, now we have the second problem, which is the most difficult. So in the first case, we have supposed that we have a realistic simulator, but it might not be the case. Why? Because in general, I mean, it's very difficult to capture the user, the citizen, the people reaction. So how people behave is very difficult to forecast and to insert in a model. So we have basically some social scientists in the project that take their approach, and their approach is basically is based on questionnaires and focus groups and interviews and so on. So I mean, we have some, I mean, at least I have some doubts about this this approach. But I will tell you why in a minute. So we are trying to develop another approach for trying to understand and to learn how people react to incentives, and then cast what we have learned into the optimization model. So what we have done is that basically we have analyzed past data, and we have understood quite a lot of things. The first one is that no matter what a region does, so no matter how much money a region invests, or maybe the money would be an issue, but basically you can see many different regions here. These are the years with the same incentive, so national incentive. We have in Italy national incentives that are feed-in tariffs, and each region has implemented its own actions and implementation instruments for fostering the use of PV. Okay, so The Sicily, in the south of Italy, they implemented many, many actions, Lombardia. So basically, the kilowatt installed, I mean, they are changing, but because the region is different. But basically, as you can see, the trend is the same, okay? So we have a big, big jump up into 2010, and then a drop down in 2012. And basically, in this region, nothing happened. So the Abruzzo region, which is in the middle of Italy, didn't do anything for fostering PV. And the trend is exactly the same. So the reason could be, in fact, that the regional funds that are allocated are much, much less than national ones. So the national ones might be leading, okay? So might be the really, really, really important. So Trentino is a region of Italy with an autonomous which is autonomous, basically, in the decisions, and they have a lot of money, so, but still the trend is more or less the same, okay? So we can see some small changes in this stuff, but not that much. But the most interesting part is the following. So these are national incentives, so these are euros per kilowatt hour. So basically, they started in 2006, with a very high amount of money per kilowatt hour, and then they are decreasing a lot in 2012, okay? And this is the trend of installed megawatt. So you see there's no relation at all. Maybe, I mean, the dropping down the big drop up in 2010 is possibly due here, and here you see the incentive has started decreasing. So basically, it's possibly due to the fact that people know that in 2012 then something would be happening, and then the incentive would have been decreased. So this is basically the megawatt installed. The same trend goes for the number of plants installed. So basically, there is this jump up in 2010, which is, I mean, goes in a different way with respect to the incentive. So what? There should be some other driver that pushes people to decide, okay, not only economic reason or maybe yes, but something else. So looking at the literature, we have that, yes, we have financial aspects that influence the choice, of course, but we have also some other aspects that should be taken into account. Of course, I mean, there are some social aspects social scientists have identified. There is a paper by Jagger of 2006 that he identifies a number of possible drivers that push people to decide whether or not to install, for example, a PV plant. So one is environmental sensitivity. So I'm very green. I want to have a PV plant on my roof. So no matter what happens from an economic perspective. The feeling of belongingness to a group. If all my neighborhoods have installed the PV plants on their roof, then I want to do the same. Feeling of freedom. I want to be free from the energy utility. I want to produce my own energy. I will not trust the government. So the government promised to give me a grant for 20 years, but I don't believe it. I mean, if we are in Italy, this is a very strong point, of course. And the perceived bureaucracy. I have to do so many things, and I will not go into this mess. And so, for example, this might be driver to decide whether or not to install a PV plant. So, how to derive a model of an agent on the basis of these parameters that are very difficult to measure? So, computational social scientists extract these parameters from questionnaires, interviews, focus groups, which is fine, but, you know, there's a problem. People lie. Why? I just make you an example. In 2009, the main Italian utility, which is Enel, made a questionnaire with questions like, would you change your energy consumption behavior if we introduce day-night tariffs apply, so in the night the energy is cheaper? And you know what? The 75% of the people said, yes, of course I will. And you know, in 2012, the real percentage of people that have changed their energy consumption behavior? 1.1%. So what does it mean? It means that we cannot ask people. We cannot simply say, tell me what you will do, because they even don't know, okay? So they think they would have changed, but then, I mean, life is so difficult. I would not make my start my hair dryer or my washing machine in the night, because it's noisy, okay? So this is the figure. So I think that we cannot simply rely on what people say. So we have to measure them in another way. So what we are doing now is, and I think it's very, very, very challenging, is to try to, okay, so first of all, we have to make an effort. We have real data. We have past data, and they are the real situation. What happened in Italy, we know all the incentives that have been given at national and regional scale, and we have the megawatt of power installed, okay? For photovoltaic, for example. So we can infer something from that. We want to create an agent with a number of parameters, and then we have to tune these parameters to do what? To obtain a behavior of the simulator that is as close as possible to the real past data. So what we have, we can tune an agent to behave as it did in the past. Now, a criticism that can be done to this approach is that, well, maybe in the future the situation changes and even the agent changes. This is true. Of course, this is true. But, you know, if you go in a two-year perspective and you slide your window from 2 years, unless a disruptive event happen, then, I mean, the situation can be maintained can be considered as realistic, I would say. So we want to tune these parameters such that the outcome of the simulation is as close as possible to that curve. So we have these three curves because they basically represent different size of PV plants, okay? So there are the small one, the medium, and very large, I mean, and not very large, but larger plants. So we are basically trying, this is a work in progress, and it's very challenging, I guess, to try to automatically tune these parameters of each agent to basically come up with a simulator that is an emerging behavior, which is basically that the megawatt installed, that is similar to the real case. So now we are considering at the first stage, we have considered the impact of each single parameter on an agent behavior. And the parameters that we are considering are the weight of social interaction, so each agent into the simulator is linked to some neighborhoods. And if these neighborhoods have installed the PV plant, then he might be more, he has a higher probability of deciding to install it or not. The area of influence, so how many neighborhoods he might influence, PV technology and efficiency, panel cost, maintenance cost of PV, the cost per kilowatt of power installed, consumption coverage, so how much energy I can self-consume, which is, for example, now with the new incentive schema is much more convenient to self-consume our own energy, and knowledge diffusion. So this is something that is almost never considered by region, but if people do not know anything about a technology, if people do not know anything about the fact that there are incentives or that there are some subsidies, then they simply will never consider the investment. So the knowledge diffusion is something that we have considered that it is very, very affecting the behavior of the simulator. So now we are doing what? We are trying to understand which parameters are most affecting the behavior of the simulator. So this is the social influence, for example. So if we change basically the strength of the social influence, we have different trends, and basically this is rather impacting. The maintenance cost of panels are almost have almost no impact. Panel cost reduction, yes, a little bit. But what has the most impact, the highest impact, is the knowledge diffusion. So if people knows about a specific technology and a specific incentive, and if you see, we are trying to obtain a trend which is growing in 2010 and dropping down in 2012, and this is much, much more similar to a real curve with respect to the other. So what we want to do now is to find a proper mix of these parameters to really, I mean, to simulate, to mimic the real curve. So we are now using a phrase to set the agent parameters, and this is a work in progress. So we want to minimize the distance between the simulator output and the real data. Of course, I mean, this is a drawback, so the current situation might be different. So this is a criticism that can that is true. I mean, it could be the case that how people decided in 2011 is different than how people decided in 2013. And for example, after Fukushima, people really changed the way of deciding, of thinking, and so on. And of course, there are disruptive events that might really cause a drastic change in the agent's behavior. But still, I mean, this is a way to validate, at least to a certain extent on past data, of a simulator that tries to mimic the user behavior, so the citizen behavior. There is a problem of scale, of course. Realistic scale are computationally intractable. At least, I mean, we have 2 million. We can, I mean, run so many simulations for 2 million agents. So we are trying to understand if there is a kind of, impact on the simulator, but growing the number of agents, and so to try to understand from lower scale simulation if behavior. We have to feed into the simulator tons of data, considering energy consumption, production, policy instruments at national or regional level, population distribution, the wealth, and so on. And of course, we have to validate and assess this on future data. But I think that this is really a key point to try to have a kind of, I mean, scientific methodology for validating a simulator on some real data. Okay, so basically, when we have the simulator and the optimization component, we can integrate this. I've just said something about that in a very light way, in a weak way, kind of generate and test manner. We can learn something from the simulator. We can also have an intermediate integration kind of based on decomposition. So the first interaction is the decision making. I mean, this part here, the blue one, produces a plan, the environmental assessment plan, then this is simulated, and the policymaker says yes or no. But the problem is, how many scenarios do we have to evaluate before the policymaker is happy? I don't know. So this is, in general, they can be very many. We can try to learn something from the simulator results, as I told you before. See, if we have a realistic simulator, and then we have the relation between the budget invested on specific investments and the megawatt installed, we can enrich our optimization model by putting some information from this relation between decision variables and the outcome. Or we can do a kind of decomposition, I mean, Bender's decomposition approach, where the decision and the optimization component generates a tentative scenario, which is simulated, then validated, and then if negative, we can insert some no goods into the optimization component and basically iterate. So these are all, I mean, possibility for integrating these two guys, so the simulator and the optimization component. And one should understand, I mean, that even, I mean, the number of simulation, if the simulator is too heavy, then I have to try to go for this direction, because this in general requires less interaction. Okay, so basically, I'm almost done. I have to say some things that are also going on in the project. So the first problem is the acceptability by policymakers. So they will never trust you if you don't show them what you are doing, if you are not collaborating with them in producing the model, and so on. So this is, I mean, very, 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 very important. We want to insert into the model also some economic perspective. We have integrating now a project that is called RAMIA, that basically understands the relation between a plant, so the environmental environmental impact and economic impact of the plan on the plan on the different production lines. We are now collaborating with Barry and Lars and Nick and Julia on an econometrics, on using econometrics for accessing financial incentives instead of a social approach. Try to consider econometrics for assessing this. And one aspect that is very important and is being considered in the project is the e-participation part. There is a partner that is doing opinion mining, and this is also very, very, very nice, very interesting. So basically, they are digging the internet, finding for blogs and forums, and extracting text, and trying to understand whether the opinion of a given test is positive, neutral, or negative, which is a nightmare. It's a really, very, very, very difficult task. Because people, uses irony, and it's very difficult. So basically, there are two approaches, the semantic-based and the statistic-based approach. But what we want to do basically is to use opinions of people to assess from a social perspective a plan. So the policymaker can kind of have a barometer measuring how much the plan that he produced, the scenario that he produced, is socially acceptable. So basically you have opinions, you collect them many different documents, you analyze all of them, and basically you try to plot the general trend of the opinions of the people. Some open direction. This is really just a small fragment of the overall picture. Why? Because basically the policy making level is the highest possible level, but you have a lot of problems. Boiling down to the energy generation, transmission, distribution, and demand, which should be taken into account in an integrated way. Because we cannot simply think that a policymaker decides and things work. Okay, so there should be many decisions and utilities, for example, should be involved. The massive use of renewable energy plants may introduce instability in the network, because the power produced is very fluctuating, as long high fluctuation, so the network might be unstable. So you have to, for example, to convince people to reuse the energy they produce as soon as they produce it. So they have to change their behavior. The energy producers and distributors, we are collaborating now with Enel, which is the main Italian utility, because they want to come up with a business model that convince people pricing schema, for example, that convince people to go in the direction of having more sustainable energy behavior. The demand response is a very important thing. So demand response is a changing in the electric user by customers from their normal consumption in response to dynamic price changes. So for example, if we convince people, and we are able either to convince people or to provide automatic tools for example, scheduling the appliances, or there was a very interesting presentation by Pascal in the workshop of Smart City about that. So you really can shift their consumption and can, for example, help them using the energy that they are producing on their with their solar panel. There is also the storage problem. So some regions are now trying to use and to go in the direction of building storage plants for storing the energy which is produced by renewable energy sources and not consumed, for example. There is a lot of things to do, and all this stuff should be put into a kind of integrated view. Because now things are decided at different level, and sometimes they do not converge. Okay, so this is it. I thank you very much for your attention. I mean, yes, the... No, I mean, you are perfectly right. I mean, the qualitative, I mean, now the policies are evaluated in a qualitative way, I mean, at all stages. And sometimes when you read a plan, an energy plan, but also another plan, you say, but how can this be achieved? And why? Because it's only being evaluated in a qualitative way. But we can, I mean, I think that we can use, of course, we can use quantitative indicators, but also with qualitative indicators. I mean, for example, we have applied some kind of fuzzy logic approach to try to use and exploit as much as possible this qualitative information. But I still think that, I mean, we have to measure things. And also, for example, for an environmental perspective, I not said anything about the monitoring part, but the monitoring part we have, I mean, really a chance of doing something, because in Emilia-Romagna we have tons of sensors, environmental sensors that are distributed all over the region, so you really have the data. So why do we have to come up with a qualitative evaluation of the policy? We have data, so we can use them for monitoring purposes and for understanding the impact of a policy, and then use them for the next one. Thank you.
I'm not going to ask a future question, but I want to ask a more general question, that when you show your plans to the decision-makers, what they react to, how difficult is it to convince them, how much work do you have to do them?
Yeah, so basically, I can answer in two parts. So the first one is that we are collaborating with one of them that is very open-minded, I have to say, but he wanted really to see what we are using in the model. So he wants to see which kind of matrices we are using, which model we are using, and then, I mean, building the model together with him, then it was acceptable. We have some troubles instead of, making the system usable for other policymakers that have not followed the construction of the model. But I think that, you can really show them that you can have an advantage in using this stuff. I mean, we have convinced this policymaker in the following way. So basically, he was designing his plan, and then we were basically starting with a prototype, a very initial prototype, and we came up with two plans that were, that were dominating it. And basically, this translates into an advantage with respect to the money and to the quality of the air. And so he was a little bit more convinced, but it's difficult, very difficult. Yep.
I actually have a follow-up question to Pascal's
question.
Yep. You're using complex optimization technology as well, a lot of agent-based simulation. Would your system be able to generate explanation to the policymaker on why they come up with such a recommendation? Because that can help the policymaker to explain the decision to the general public as well.
Yeah. No, we are already working on that. So first of all, we are trying now to work on the explanation of why not. So because if, for example, the policymaker wants to come up with a budget of, I don't know, 2 million euros to foster, a huge penetration of, like PV or biomasses or whatever, then we cannot produce a plan. And so now we are trying to understand which is the best explanation, and basically we are saying with these ranges, you cannot achieve what you want, but these are, so we provide basically minimum ranges for him or her but yes, the explanation is an extremely important part.
It's a question.
Francois?
Offer?
Serious games, yeah. No, this is definitely an avenue to investigate. I mean, that's of a serious game on, I mean, and game theory in general, and also, I mean, Wiseberry. I mean, they are also using, I mean, at 4C, the mechanism design and game theory to try to, I mean, to converge to an equilibrium to different agents. But yeah, this is definitely something that we have to investigate in detail. Okay, thank you very much.